Dr. Groh has been the project director of the federally funded Rehab Research and Training Center on Secondary Conditions after SEI since 2003 and is the current project director of the National Capital Spinal Cord Injury Model System. She has a subspecialty certification in SCI from the American Board of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation and has been a writer for the ABPMR SCI subspecialty examination for the past 3 years. She reviews regularly for the Archives of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, Spinal Cord, American Journal of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, Journal of Spinal Cord Medicine, and Journal of Neurotrauma. She has been an expert panel member for the PVA Consortium Guideline on Bladder Management and is currently an expert panel member for the upcoming PVA Consortium Guideline on Carbohydrate and Lipid Disorders after SCI. Dr. Groh was recently identified in 2009 and 2010 Best Doctors in America for the District of Columbia, and in 2008 was nominated for the NSCIA SCI Hall of Fame. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Groh.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and thanks for having me. Thanks to Dr. Steve Williams for asking me up here. I've never been to this conference before, so this is a pleasure. And I have the pleasure, I don't know if you guys have the pleasure, since we have, we're missing one speaker, I can just talk forever this afternoon, but you guys might kill me, so we'll see. So if it starts going on too long, just raise your hands, let me know. But what I'm going to be talking about today is successful aging with spinal cord injury, myth or fact. And we have a couple objectives, and I'm going to have to give you a little background before we go over these objectives, and they might influence how you look at this talk a little bit. After I finished residency, I did two fellowships, actually. I did a two-year fellowship in aging with spinal cord injury at Craig Hospital, and then I did what I called my remedial fellowship because I evidently needed more training. And that's when I got excited and interested about aging and aging with spinal cord injury. And at that time, I used to give aging with spinal cord injury talk an awful lot, and I would get, you get reviews afterwards. And I'd always get good reviews. People would say it's a great talk, great information, but it's a downer. And then they'd ask me, can you make it really uplifting? And I ask you, can I make it uplifting? Because I don't know. And this is a new talk now. I've taken my old talk. I went a different way for a few years. I'm back to aging. I'm going to try to make it uplifting. We'll see. Try to think of me trying to make it uplifting and trying really, really hard. So I'm going to try to have you leave here not thinking so much that aging is such a downer, because it's really not. So these are the objectives. Think about these questions. Think if you think they're myth or fact, okay? And again, let's all have fun today. So disease and aging are synonymous. Is that a myth or fact? That's okay. These are questions for you, not for me. Everyone leaves with their own feelings. Older people are less physically active. Myth or fact? There you go. Older people are less mentally active. Myth or fact? We have the middle of the road person up here. I don't know if you guys can hear it, but every question, some. And aging is associated with poorer quality of life. Myth or fact? Okay. So I have more questions for the audience. And actually, I was going to try a whole new thing today, and I'm kind of glad I didn't, where, if any of you give presentations, this is kind of fun. And I'm into fun things when I do my presentations. So there's a new thing where you can ask questions and everyone can pull out their phone and text you a response, and then it tallies it up. But I figured this was probably not the time to try that because it would fail miserably. So I'll just go the old route and we'll ask more questions. getting back to my previous reviews on this aging talk and everyone who said, wow, this is all great information, but can you make it more uplifting? Let me ask you guys these three questions, and this is for my benefit. Raise of hands, clap of hands, whatever you want to do. Text your message. I don't have anywhere to text for you to text to yet, but you can still text. How many people feel like you are aging? All right. That helps. How many people feel like you're aged or old? Okay, considerably fewer. And is aging a good thing? Oh, that was pretty universal. I didn't even have my... Where's the lady who was saying some? I didn't even have her helping me out here. Is aging a good thing? A little bit. All right, so this question isn't up here, but since that's the response, which is what I expected, let me ask one more question. How many of you would rather go back to high school right now? Okay. So maybe the young lady right here who answered some to everything is really right. Yeah, there's some bad things with aging. There's some good things with aging. Okay? All right, so let's try to get a little bit of background information. What is normal aging? It's kind of a tough question. Is that normal aging? This is normal aging. That would be really cool. Who recognizes these guys? All right, I mean, again, another question. Who recognizes these guys? All right. And I will say they were before my time, just a tweech. Another picture of these guys. Do you know what the amazing thing is? There is 35 years of time between these two pictures. Have they aged at all? Oh, yeah, there's a little makeup. One of the pictures is from 1975. One of the pictures is from 2010. 35 years. Can you guys identify which picture is from 1975 and which is from 2010? Ching, ching. Can you believe it? These guys are doing something right. Right? They're doing something right. They're probably doing something wrong, but they're also doing something right. So, is this normal aging? Is this successful aging? I don't even know if we could tell if they had plastic surgery. It'd be tough. But they're doing something right. Is this normal aging? Could be. Depends who normal is. And the other question is, so clearly normal aging is pretty darn hard to define. The other question is, that we really muddle with is, when does aging start? Yeah, that's one theory. So does it start at birth? And if you guys can't see it in the background, the little red thing in the panda bear's mouth is a newborn little baby panda bear. Yeah, aww. Everyone together now. Aww, perfect. So, some people are of the camp that aging starts at birth. Yeah. Or, does aging start when you're a child and you start moving around, when you start seeing the physical milestones? Or does aging start when you're a little bit older and you start being more socially interactive? Or does aging start in kindergarten? Or does aging start in second grade? I don't know that. I don't know the answer to that question either. A lot of people say a lot of different things. Some people are of the camp that aging starts with the little pink panda bear in the mom's mouth right at the time of birth. Some people say it starts later on. In spinal cord injury, we've often talked that aging starts, you know, at various times, starting at age 50. Whomp, aging starts. Which doesn't really make a whole lot of sense to me. But that's one of the questions we're going to think about today. Okay? So, aging in general is a muddy issue. Some people say, you know, there's a biologic clock that go off. Some people say that there's an increase in DNA damage with time. There's the immune theory. There's the wear and tear theory. There's the failure of maintenance theory. There's the evolutionary theory. And then again, there are those folks that say that aging starts at birth. What we do know is that organ functions, I'm a physician, so I talk about body organs, starting somewhere in your 20s, probably early to mid-20s, function of your organs in general starts going downhill. We know that, okay? You add SCI into the picture, and it makes aging even muddier, okay? Complicating factors associated with spinal cord injury, you know, include whatever aging that occurred before the injury. Some people are injured when they're 20, some people are injured when they're 40, some people are injured when they're 60, a lot of people are injured in between. There is, in most cases, some degree of aging that occurred before the injury occurred, and that's important. How old were you at the time of injury? How many years has it been since your injury? How many years have you lived with the spinal cord injury? What era were you injured in? That's a really important point. If someone was injured 30 or 40 years ago, medical and rehabilitative care was much different than it is today. And you were probably exposed to medicine and rehabilitation much differently than people are today. And I'm not saying one is good and one is bad, but they are very different and they affect your life very differently. And then along with that, exposure to medical care and medications over the course of a lifetime. Okay. All these muddy and already muddy picture. Okay. And then we, as a scientific community, in my opinion, have made it a little muddier even because of the way we've talked. Because as we've tried to describe aging, we've tried to classify conditions that occur with aging. We try to figure out if that diabetes was actually in existence or not prior to your SCI. Or is that condition associated with your SCI, or did that SCI cause that condition? And I think we've sort of muddied the waters by talking in these terms, and I don't know that it helps consumers with spinal cord injury. Okay? So the field is muddy. How we've talked about it doesn't necessarily work, and how we've thought about aging maybe doesn't work. So to add clarity, or at least a little bit of clarity, to the concept of aging with spinal cord injury, I'd like to suggest that instead of thinking of health conditions or different type of functioning as, you know, being due to or secondary to the spinal cord injury or being in existence beforehand, that the spinal cord injury from the day of injury alters aging. And I can tell you that is a fact. The spinal cord injury alters the trajectory of aging, you know, through a potential, and I added in potential at the last minute. We don't even have to say potential, but an impact on every body system. And then the impact on the body system impacts physical, social, and emotional function. And if we can better understand how the spinal cord injury actually changes the trajectory of aging, and what I mean by trajectory, I'll show you a little bit later on, then we can do some things to positively impact health, function, and aging as a whole. We can do things through prevention. And then we can take the next step and start impacting policy change to improve delivery and then healthcare services. That was the questions I heard in the last talk about working with insurance companies, okay, to make sure what people need gets paid for. So what I'm going to do is each of these next few slides could actually be a talk unto itself. But I'm going to talk a little bit about, you know, the interactions between health conditions and aging and spinal cord injury and try to make it a little bit less muddy. So what do we know about health conditions that occur in an older population? We know there are an increased occurrence of certain health conditions like Alzheimer's and other dementias, arthritis, cancer, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, hypertension, osteoporosis. These are just a few. So let's talk about a few of these. What do we know? Let's just talk about a few of the systems to really develop kind of this new thinking about aging. So what happens with the skin as we age? Well, an aging fact is that the skin becomes less flexible and thins, and wounds don't heal as well. So thinking about the interaction with spinal cord injury, what do we know happens with spinal cord injury? Well, people with spinal cord injury are at higher risk of pressure sores. They're not only at higher risk, but they also happen with pretty high frequency. About 15% of the population, not just the spinal cord injury population, across the board in industrialized countries. 15% of the population has a pressure wound at any given time. That's a pretty high percentage. We know in spinal cord injury, it's the most common cause of illness, and the risk increases with increasing age. So if you put those two together, aging and skin and spinal cord injury, we know from the evidence that more pressure sores occur over time and with age in people with spinal cord injury. What about musculoskeletal changes? And there's our hopefully goal for normal aging. We know in general that as people age, flexibility decreases, range of motion decreases, bone mass decreases, so there's more osteoporosis, and as a result, fractures increase. So what do we know in people with spinal cord injury? We know that people with spinal cord injury experience overuse of their arms, putting their arms and shoulders at risk. And we know that osteoporosis is nearly universal. Not totally, but almost everyone with spinal cord injury has osteoporosis. And this is not necessarily associated with age, but it occurs very rapidly after the spinal cord injury, just within weeks to months. So you put together aging and the musculoskeletal system, the spinal cord injury, and what we know from the research is that paraplegics in particular tend to have a lot more joint pain with time, more so than people with tetraplegia or quadriplegia. We also know that with age and with time, we're seeing a lot more rotator cuff tendonitis and rotator cuff tears, which have a huge impact on function. And then we put together aging and spinal cord injury and bone. And as I said before, osteoporosis is, you know, we can call it universal after spinal cord injury. It pretty much happens in everybody, with the rare exception. Although this is not necessarily related to age, it's more so related to the injury itself. It occurs very rapidly after injury, but the important thing is, whereas osteoporosis would have typically occurred later in life for people, it occurs at the time of injury, and then we're aging with that osteoporosis. And what does that mean? So what happens to the immune system with age? We know that there's a reduced ability to fight infection. We know a fact is there's a reduced responsiveness to vaccinations, and we know that there's an increased risk of autoimmune diseases. What do we know happens in the spinal cord injury population? We know from data that there's an increased risk of certain infections. Okay. Namely, the respiratory infections. And in typically people, spinal cord injury or not, associated with aging, there's a natural reduction in lung function with age. That will occur in people with spinal cord injury as well. But in addition, people with spinal cord injury, depending on your level of injury, have some compromised lung and breathing function in addition to this. Okay. Obviously, this is more so in tetraplegics compared with paraplegics. Kidney and bladder function. An aging fact is that kidney or renal function declines gradually with age. What happens in spinal cord injury? We know that infections of the urinary tract are one of the most common causes of illness, along with skin breakdown. And they're very, very common. So we put together aging and spinal cord injury, and we tend to get more urinary and respiratory tract infections. Especially with the respiratory tract infections, these tend to increase with age. Bowel function, what happens with quote-unquote normal aging, and then what happens in spinal cord injury? We know with normal aging, there's a reduction in natural bowel contractions. We know that there's a reduced tolerance for certain foods, and we know that there's decreased vitamin and mineral absorption. I didn't put it on here, but we also know that bowel disorders, especially constipation, is more common. What do we know in people with spinal cord injury? We know that hemorrhoids tend to be associated with older age in people with spinal cord injury and people who have been injured longer. So maybe a little bit more gallbladder disease. But the biggie is there's an increase in the time it takes food to go through the colon, which leads to an increase in constipation with age. So you put some of these together, aging plus SCI, and we do, with age, get more constipation, but in general, whether it's constipation or not, more bowel care problems. What happens to your endocrine system? In normal aging, we know that in women, there's decreased ovarian function. In men, there's reduced testicular function. We do see more diabetes with age, and we do see more thyroid dysfunction or thyroid disease. How does that correlate with spinal cord injury? Is spinal cord injury any different? We know, observing people with spinal cord injury, that with age and with time since injury, we do see more diabetes, we do see more insulin resistance. This is kind of a new field, but we suspect also that we're seeing more or reduced testicular function as well in men. So what do we then get when we combine aging and SCI? We do get more diabetes and inflammation. I didn't talk about inflammation much because I knew Dr. Nash was going to talk about it in the previous lecture. And I'll go into it a little further here, but he did allude to especially fat around the abdomen or around the belly in people with spinal cord injury. And fat is not a benign mass. We used to think of fat as just extra weight that we carried around, but it's not extra weight. It's actually a good way to think about it is another organ of the body. Fat is very active, and fat releases and stimulates the release of all these inflammatory mediators that lead to this systemic inflammatory state in many, many people with spinal cord injury. And that's very linked with diabetes and some of the other cardiovascular diseases. So what do we know about cardiovascular system aging? We know from the general population there's an increased incidence of heart disease with aging, an increased incidence of hypertension, higher cholesterol levels, more glucose intolerance, which obviously leads to the diabetes. So what do we see in spinal cord injury? It's a little bit different picture. We actually see less hypertension for some people, not all people. Paraplegics tend to have about the same amount of hypertension as people without spinal cord injury. Tetraplegics tend to have less hypertension. We tend to see lower HDL cholesterol. The problem is HDL cholesterol is the good one. That's the one you want to have high. We do tend to see more obesity. And as I explained in the last slide, we also tend to see more inflammation, which is related to the obesity. This is a little video we put together, and this is just talking a little bit more about the obesity and the impact of obesity. So this is data actually from the general population. This is not spinal cord injury specific data, but just to give you a feel for what's going on in the general population. The blue states are states which have a higher prevalence of obesity, okay? The lighter color blue, for those of you who can't see, it's probably too small, is less than 10% of the state is obese. The darker blue is 10 to 14%. You can see as we go through the years, our country is getting darker and darker, and pretty soon it's going to be even darker because we're going to have to add a new color here. I always tell people to pick your state and see how your state does. And actually, I haven't done this presentation in Massachusetts yet, so I need to look at that and see where we are. But now the darkest blue is 15 to 19% of the population in 1993 is obese. And this is not overweight, but this is obese. Okay? So at this point, our whole country is some shade of blue. And again, we're running out of blues. We can't go much darker. So I'm sure, as you can guess, we're going to have to add another color soon. And there we go. The yellow is greater than 20% of the population of that state is obese. How many of you think this is the last color we're going to add? Because we're only at 1999. Pretty soon we'll add another color. But it's remarkable, just year by year, the change. And the orange is greater than 25% of the population of that state is obese. So over the period of 15 years so far, we've changed from a gray country to a light blue country, and now we've even made it through all the blues, and we're working on oranges. And yes, I think there will be another color. So the red is greater than 30% of the population is obese. So this has been what's happening in the general population in the United States and other industrialized countries for the last 20 years or so. You know, I think we've all heard about the obesity epidemic or pandemic, you want to call it, but I always feel like this video kind of really, really demonstrates it. This is what's happening in the United States. We can't expect a whole lot of difference in the spinal cord injury population. We would expect about the same kind of phenomenon. So when we put aging and spinal cord injury together in the context of obesity, we actually have greater obesity in people with spinal cord injury than in the general population. And it's not because, you know, necessarily you eat more. It's not because you eat more unhealthy, and we're going to talk about that in a second. But it's because after spinal cord injury, there's just a profound change in body composition. There's some wasting of muscles and there's substitution of fat. And if you actually look, if you look using DEXA scans to look at fat mass and muscle mass, about 75% of people with spinal cord injury can be classified as overweight or obese by those measures. We typically use something called BMI, or body mass index, in the clinic, which is, you know, the little table where we measure your height and measure your weight, put it on a table, and estimate what your BMI is. So a BMI of greater than 25 is overweight or obese. Problem is, it doesn't work at all in people with spinal cord injury. And people who, for whatever reason, spinal cord injury or whatever reason, whose body composition has been changed for some reason, BMI doesn't work. So, and it's important because we use BMI sort of universally in the clinics to estimate future risk of disease. In people with spinal cord injury, BMI drastically underestimates that risk. So we can't use it. And that's some of the work we're trying to do right now. Dr. Nash and I are actually working together on a 5-year project to try to get enough data so we can actually make new tables just for people with spinal cord injury. But I guess the take-home message is, for a number of reasons, people with spinal cord injury are more overweight and more obese. The other key is BMI doesn't work. The other key is eyeballing someone doesn't work. A lot of my patients, my athletes, may look thin, may look of normal weight, but the spinal cord injury has caused this change. So we know we have that underlying risk of overweight or obesity. So what does that mean for cardiovascular disease? And I think Dr. Nash did a great job of summarizing this in the previous lecture. But what we know is there's a change in the risk factors cardiovascular disease for people with spinal cord injury. We see a lot more overweight and obesity. Because of that, you know, fat actually releases inflammatory mediators. We see a lot more inflammation, which is one of the prime areas of research right now, just in cardiovascular disease. We see lower HDL cholesterol, the good cholesterol. We're actually seeing more diabetes, probably in tetraplegics, more so than paraplegics, okay? But the question that we don't know the answer to is, does this lead to more cardiovascular disease? We can make the assumption that it does, but we don't know the answer. We're trying to get there, but we're not there yet. We just know that the risk factors are there. So that was just sort of a brief overview of some of the changes that occur with aging. And again, I had to kind of give you the 30,000 foot view, because each of those could be a talk in and of themselves. But what I want you to start thinking about is, you put aging with spinal cord injury together, and what do you get? We get some health conditions are going to occur with more frequency, okay? You put aging and spinal cord injury together, and it will be a lot less, but there will be some health conditions that actually occur with less frequency. You know, the most obvious one is hypertension for people with tetraplegia. Okay, that occurs with less frequency. And so aging for people with spinal cord injury is different. Okay? It is, some things are going to be similar, some things are going to be the same. And it's not the same for every individual. Just like the people we showed in the beginning with the woman stretching her leg up to the sign. It's different for every single person. Okay? The key is, how do we start aging successfully? And I think that's kind of what we all want to know. And how successful have we been at helping people age with spinal cord injury? We've actually, and I don't know if people in this room have heard it, but at least in kind of the research and the scientific writings, we have been writing quite a bit, actually, over the past 10 and 20 years, how we are doing so much better, and we mean the scientific community, at helping people more successfully age with spinal cord injury. And people with spinal cord injury are aging so they can finally experience some of these chronic diseases. Well, is that really true? I mean, we look back in the 1950s, and yes, you know, back in the 1950s and earlier, if someone had a spinal cord injury, the likelihood of that person dying at a younger age was much greater than now. Okay? But at the same time, over the course of the whole 20th century, in the United States and other industrialized countries, there has been an increase in life expectancy. There is an aging of the general population. And again, not only in the United States, but throughout industrialized countries. Have people with spinal cord injury seen the same benefits? Okay. Have people with spinal cord injury seen the same increases in life expectancy? And are we really on target when we say people are aging more successfully? Well, I challenge that a little bit, and so let's look at it. Again, just as a review, industrialized nations have seen an aging of the population. In this country, the number of people in the oldest age groups is increasing proportionately. Okay? So this is data, and this is a little bit of a busy slide. And I'll walk you through it because I know the numbers are small. But this is actually data from our National Model Systems database, which is, albeit small, it captures about 15% of the U.S. spinal cord injured population, but it's the best we got. And this looks at life expectancy of people with spinal cord injury. So for each group of columns, the red bars are general population data, so people without spinal cord injury. So the first two columns where you see 1996 and 2010, those are life expectancies for people injured in 1996 and 2010 at the age of 20. The next two clusters that begin with 40 are people that were injured at those 2 years, but they were injured at the age of 40. And then the last two clusters on the right are people that were injured at the age of 60. So again, use the red bars for each group as your marker. And you can see across the board, people without spinal cord injury live longer than people with spinal cord injury. But now let's look within the clusters. Because what we want to see is, if you look at the red bars and you look at the 20-year-olds, so the first two clusters, life expectancy change between 1996 and 2010, you see an increase in that red bar, so an increase in the life expectancy. The yellow columns are people with motor incomplete injuries, the blue columns are people with paraplegia, the green columns are people with low tetraplegia, the orange columns are people with high tetraplegia, and the purple columns are people on ventilators. So basically, when you go from yellow to blue to green to orange to purple, it's people with increasing severity of spinal cord injury. So for people injured at age 20 and age 40, people with motor incomplete spinal cord injury saw an increase in their life expectancy, but it still did not match that of the general population. What becomes alarming is for each cluster, when we see no change between 1996 or a decrease. Okay? And it's kind of hard for me to point from here, but if I look over the slide, those with paraplegia who were injured at 20 years old actually saw a reduction in their life expectancy over that 14-year timeline when the rest of the population was increasing in their life expectancy. It becomes more prominent for those who were injured at 40 and those who were injured at 60. For those who were injured at 40, there was a reduction in life expectancy over the 14-year period for paraplegics, low tetraplegics, high tetraplegics, and people on ventilators. Okay? Then when you look at those injured at age 60, we see the same reductions in life expectancy. Now, part of this might be a little bit of how we collect the data, but the issue is we should be seeing increases in life expectancy at least similar to the degree seen in the U.S. general population. And that is not what we're seeing across the board. The other thing that's obvious from this is that still life expectancy for people with spinal cord injury is not keeping pace with that seen in the U.S. general population. And that's what we need to change, and that's what we need to affect. This is just another slide to basically say the same thing. I said earlier in my talk, I'd like to leave here thinking a little bit different about aging and spinal cord injury. The way I would like to think about it is from the day you have your spinal cord injury, that really changes your aging trajectory, and that's what this diagram is supposed to show. The red line, again, the colors correlate with the colors in the previous slide. So the red line shows, this is kind of life expectancy data from the U.S. population. The first dashed line is SCI at age 20, the second dashed line is SCI at age 40, and the third dashed line is SCI at age 60. So depending on the severity of the spinal cord injury, that aging trajectory goes down. If you have a motor incomplete injury, it goes down to the yellow line. If you have high tetraplegia, it goes down to the orange line. But that's what the data show us. Okay? So I'm really trying not to be gloomy, but I have to give you the data too. The bottom line is, while we talk about we're doing so much better in aging with spinal cord injury, my question is, or my challenge is, yeah, we're doing better, but we still got quite a ways to go. So we really need to come together to work, to do a lot more research, because these numbers need to be increased. Okay? We're not where we need to be, and we shouldn't be satisfied with where we are. Mike DeVivo, who's one of the researchers, he runs the National Model Systems Database down at the University of Alabama. He's actually putting together a new paper, which will be published in just a couple months. And just on this data, on life expectancy data, and this is actually a quote from his paper, and it says, the percentage of elderly persons with spinal cord injury will not increase meaningfully until significant progress is made in reducing the high annual mortality rates currently observed among older persons with spinal cord injury. Those who reach older ages will typically have incomplete and or lower levels of injuries and will have relatively high degrees of physical independence and overall good health and community participation. And what that means is what the last few slides showed. For all but the least severely injured, we're not going as far as we need to go in improving survival and improving aging. So what do we do? Okay. So in sum a little bit for that section, you put aging and spinal cord injury together, and to me, at least, clearly the spinal cord injury really changes the trajectory of aging and the occurrence of health conditions. Roe and Kahn, this quote is from Roe and Kahn, who are they're experts in aging overall, and their model of successful aging is multidimensional, encompassing the avoidance of disease and disability, the maintenance of high physical and cognitive function, and sustained engagement in social and productive activities. And this is the little schematic of how they describe successful aging. So again, physical function, cognitive function, and social engagement. And in this talk, we really talk mainly about the blue bubble, although all the bubbles clearly interact and have an impact on each other. But the question is, How do we try to promote all those bubbles for people with spinal cord injury? Well, again, I'm going to talk about the blue bubble. And so what I do is take Ro and Khan's, they also have recommendations to promote successful aging, and try to sort of overlay what we know about spinal cord injury and aging onto what they talk about. And this is what I've come up with. So they talk about avoiding disease. Remember the quote I talked about earlier in Survival came from Mike DeVivo. In his article, he talks about the three main causes of death for people with spinal cord injury. So his three top, I call them dangers, are infection and blood clots and pneumonia or other respiratory disease for people with spinal cord injury. Okay. And in some of the papers he puts out, it's really striking how these three conditions stand apart from all others in terms of causing decline in people with spinal cord injury. And then as people age, getting back to Ro and Khan's recommendations, they recommend avoiding cancer, typically happens in older age, and controlling risk factors for heart disease and stroke, which you heard a lot about in the last talk. So from this, we make Dr. Ro's foolproof, will always work, and I guarantee it, no money back, anti-aging elixir. And so what do you need to take home to successfully age? Because I preface this with aging is very muddy. Good nutrition, okay? And I'll talk about that in the next slide, I think. Activity, and mixing it up with your activity, but staying consistent, as Dr. Nash talked about in the last talk. Prevention, prevention, prevention. I'll talk about it a little more. Avoiding excess medication use, if possible, and doing a lot of planning ahead. So I promised a little bit of a talk on nutrition. Dr. Nash and I have worked together quite a bit looking at nutrition issues in people with spinal cord injury. And what we did is one of the large-scale studies, and I think he talked about the article a little bit. We looked at nutrition intake of about, 125 people with spinal cord injury and tried to compare it to the general population to try to formulate some recommendations. And as we did that, we also looked at a lot of detail in terms of not only fats, carbohydrates, and proteins, but vitamins and minerals, and we really looked at everything. And what we came up with was actually quite remarkable. A, in the point he pointed out, that it was actually very similar to an 18-year-old study. And we talk about the 18-year-old study because there's been so little done looking at diet in people with spinal cord injury. There's very little out there. But what's more remarkable is that this was the caloric intake was almost right in line with what you would see for sort of U.S. population data, except a few hundred calories lower. So the first bar over here, we split people up by male and female and tetraplegic, paraplegic. So the first bar is males with tetraplegia. The second bar is males with paraplegia. The third bar, which I would ask you to throw out, is females with tetraplegia. I kind of have to report it, but honestly, it's only one person, so it really doesn't count. And then the last bar on the right is females with paraplegia. The blue boxes are protein intake, the yellow boxes are fat intake, and the green boxes are carbohydrate intake. But what you see is exactly what we're seeing in the U.S. population now, which is higher fat intake that's recommended. In our male tetraplegics, we're seeing 38%. Our male paraplegics, about 35%. You really want that number to be less than 30%. The group that was quite good across the board were the female paraplegics, actually. I mean, they were kind of right on par for the most part with guidelines in terms of dietary intake. The other piece that surprised us, though, was total caloric intake. For all groups, excluding the female tetraplegic, total caloric intake was actually, for the men, about a couple hundred calories a day less than that seen in people without spinal cord injury. And then the female paraplegics actually took in about 500 calories a day less than what you'd see in the general population. And so if you look at the totals, the female paraplegics took in around 1,700 calories a day. The males across the board took in about 2,000. It's not that much. They're very, very close to what's out there in recommended values. Okay. So what we learned from this is, though, we do know, and part of this study was our obesity study at the same time. So we also looked at these folks, and we found that despite these diets, 75% of people were still overweight or obese. And what it told us was what we thought clinically, is that, and this first statement is for people right after injury. It's been sort of common medical practice, acutely after injury, to give people a very high calorie diet. And people don't need that, okay? Because we know long-term there's a higher risk of overweight and obesity, so we don't need to start people out on the wrong foot initially. What we also realized is there's a really, really tight window here between getting adequate caloric intake, not getting too much caloric intake, but getting adequate vitamin and mineral intake. In the dietary study, we did see reductions in some vitamins, not a whole lot. One of the big ones was fiber. But it's a very tight window. I mean, we talk about particular diets, and I also recommend the Mediterranean diet, but you just have to really, what we are trying to do now is really recommend and bring people back to a nutritionist, even, you know, years after injury, so we can just revisit trying to encourage a very fiber and nutrient dense diet. And again, unfortunately, there's very little room for error in terms of diet. Prevention. So prevention for me is a really big issue. We've gone over some of the body systems and some of the things that happen with aging, and then some of the health conditions that might be changed by spinal cord injury and aging. We need to keep revisiting that periodically so we can intervene and prevent problems from occurring before they happen. Okay? So some preventive care may be done sooner, or sooner than usual, or maybe spinal cord injury specific. So these are my recommendations for prevention. Everyone should be doing the general recommended health maintenance for the general population. Women start getting mammography at 40 years old. Okay. Men start getting prostate exams, et cetera, et cetera. These are some of the key points, though, that may need to be done earlier or with greater frequency or a little bit different in people with spinal cord injury. The big one is vaccinations. Don't skip vaccinations. Try to get those vaccinations religiously. And I've actually just added this in based on that data that I showed you from Mike DeVivo, that across the board, infections are what's really giving people problems long term. Okay, so try to cover those infections. Get vaccinated when you're supposed to get vaccinated. I am a big proponent for DEXAs. DEXA is the x-ray where you can look at body composition and bone. I'm not saying you have to get DEXAs all the time, but what I am saying is DEXAs are helpful to actually quantify your body composition, okay, to really tell if you're overweight or obese, because we know that BMI doesn't work. And there is an adjustment out there for spinal cord injury. The adjustment is if someone with a spinal cord injury has a BMI of 22 to 25, that should be considered overweight. 25 or greater should be considered obese. I could show you a bunch of data, but that seems very conservative. Okay, I don't think that adjustment's enough. So if anyone, especially if anyone does any standing, if anyone does any walking, we know that bone loss is universal. As Dr. Nash said, we don't know the fracture threshold, but a DEXA can give you information on bone and body composition. It's helpful to do that, I think, sometime in the first year after injury, and then if the situation presents itself, possibly later down the road as well. Cholesterol levels. You definitely want to get regular, as guideline recommended, screening of cholesterol. People with spinal cord injury are more likely to have low HDLs. HDL is the good cholesterol. If you look at some of Dr. Nash's work from about 5 to 8 years ago, he did a study that was just in men with paraplegia, and if I remember correctly, their average age was somewhere in the mid-30s. And about half of those men, based on their cholesterol levels, needed some kind of intervention. Okay, so my recommendation is, if you've had your spinal cord injury for a few years, cholesterol check is worthwhile, at least starting at age 35. OGTT is an oral glucose tolerance test. What we've found from some of our research is that when we look at our cardiovascular risk factors, what I call disorders of carbohydrate metabolism or diabetes or pre-diabetes, problems with your blood sugar tend to be more common in people with tetraplegia. Now, the key point, one of the key take-home points, which I probably should have put up here, but I didn't, is that what we have found, and this has just been in some of our recent research, is if you do a regular blood test, just looking at blood sugar, these abnormalities don't show up. Okay? We looked at, again, 100 and some people with paraplegia and tetraplegia, looked at blood glucoses, and they were all normal across the board on average. But when we actually looked at oral glucose tolerance tests, which is a little more in-depth test and can identify pre-diabetes, we found that a lot of the tetraplegics especially had some abnormalities. So I do think in tetraplegias this test is worthwhile. And then I didn't talk about bladder cancer at all. I always bring it up here because that's the first area where I did some of my research. Bladder cancer is a rare cancer, a fairly unusual cancer. I think it's fifth on the list in frequency. But what we do know is in some people with spinal cord injury, the risk of bladder cancer is elevated. What it appears is that it's people with who use indwelling catheters, so either Foley catheters or suprapubic catheters for long term. excuse me. So bladder cancer screening for people who have had indwelling catheters for 5 or 10 years or more. And bladder cancer screening is changing fairly often. I mean, the classic screening is actually getting a cystoscopy, but there are newer urine tests on the market, and so that's kind of changing frequently. But it is worthwhile asking that question. And exercise. Dr. Nash talked a lot about exercise, but this is key. This is key to maintaining function. It's key to maintaining interactions in society and the community as well. But as Dr. Nash went over, you can improve fitness levels, improve cholesterol, and reduce diabetes risk with exercise. We know that from general population data, but we know that from some research we've done in spinal cord injury. Okay, so those cardiovascular risk factors can be improved with exercise. I mentioned in an earlier slide on exercise to mix it up. Dr. Nash talked about that as well. Definitely mix in some resistance exercise, but keep yourself exercising. Keep it interesting. Keep it fun. Try to mix in some aerobic and some anaerobic. And then I like to quote what I call the DUH study. This is a study we did over the past 5 years that we finished up last year, and it was kind of surprising, but so the whole idea of our study was that people who exercise are healthier and people who don't exercise are not as healthy. Frighteningly, that hadn't been done in spinal cord injury yet, so that's why I call it the DUH study. I can't even remember what the title is at this point. So what we did is we did two studies, actually. We did this large survey of almost 800 people, asking these questions in much greater detail than that. And then we did a second study, which was a randomized controlled trial of exercise. Basically, what we found is, sure enough, not only when people reported to us in surveys, but also when we looked at them over time and we put them in an exercise program, the people who exercised had fewer other health conditions. And we even measured, skin breakdown, urinary tract infections, respiratory infections, sort of the big ones that we've been talking about. And people that exercised had fewer of these. Okay. And then plan. Okay? Plan for possible mobility changes over age. Plan for the possibility of increased assistance. If you know, rotator cuff tendonitis and rotator cuff tears, I'm seeing increasingly more in people with spinal cord injury. We need to have a backup plan. And while a rotator cuff tear won't cause you to, you know, isn't a cause of death, for example, what it is it's a cause of other problems, you know, because there is an incredible impairment and function associated with it. If you get your rotator cuff repaired, you have got to be down for quite a while. And what I do see is people who tear their rotator cuff, they get it repaired, they end up in bed, and then all this other stuff happens, all these other conditions that we talk about. So have a plan and a backup plan. Plan on upgrading equipment as you age. Okay, there's going to be a need, you know, for different equipment and for different functional needs. Plan to stay socially active and active in your community. And plan to stay in touch or connected through whatever means. Because remember, when we go back to those three bubbles of successful aging, we've been talking a lot about physical function, but we've got to stay mentally active and we've got to stay active in the community. Those are real keys to successful aging. So what does successful aging in spinal cord injury means? Well, we need to do a couple things. We not only need to add years to life, but we also need to add life to years. So let's get back to our first couple questions. And I'll let you answer for yourselves, just like I did when I started this. So are disease and aging synonymous? Do they have to occur together? Or do you have some control over them? Okay. Are older people less physically active? For those of you who didn't hear, the sum is back. Are older people less mentally active? Maybe if you are, then you are older. And is aging associated with diminished quality of life? Not necessarily. We actually have some fairly good data on this one in spinal cord injury. And actually, if you look at it, because in the aging population, there is an increase in depression. People with spinal cord injury from report at least quality of life and perceived well-being pretty much on par with their aging peers without spinal cord injury. Okay. So how many of you think most of these are myth or most of these are fact? You can just yell it out. Okay, good. So maybe we've been a little more uplifting. So what do we really know about aging and spinal cord injury? We know some, and we're learning, but there's still a lot to learn. And how do we age successfully, just to wrap up? So get and stay active physically. This is for everyone, regardless of spinal cord injury. Get and stay active mentally. Prevention. Enjoy libations in moderation. And take Dr. Groh's works every time elixir. Never fails, because these guys did. And this is them in 2010 and not 1975. These guys did. And then remember our panda bears? These guys did. And they're aging well. All right. Thank you.
So we're going to take some questions. There's a gentleman down front here. Thanks, Mike.
Okay, just a quick question. Mark Ryder from New Hampshire again. It seems like every spinal cord injury that I know of, there's always, like you said, either osteoporosis or osteoporosis. Why? I guess there's some drugs out there, Actinel and Boniva. Is that been shown to decrease or increase the bone mass?
Well, if we saw the news reports of this week, I have used some of the medications, the osteoporosis medications we see out there. I've used them in some of my patients who especially are up walking. Although for those of you who didn't see the FDA warning this week on Fosamax and femur fractures, or some association with both Fosamax and femur fractures, there hasn't been any studies per se. You know, but again, when there's no studies in spinal cord injury specifically, you know, we still need to follow just sort of regular medical guidelines. Okay, so regular medical guidelines would tell me yes, especially in my patients who are up and again walking or standing or you know doing, for example, some of the Locomed trials. I may use them, although again the Fosamax warning this week makes me want to look at that a little closer.
We have actually two questions over here.
I have kind of two questions, one person, one kind of general. You were mentioning decreased mineral and so forth uptake. How much of that is compensated for by taking a lot of supplements like heavy-duty multivitamins, heavy-duty sea fish oil, and so forth? And the second one is part of my injury is a class 3 shoulder separation that I've been debating whether or not to try to get the surgery on to have it worked on, which is going to give me 6 to 12 months downtime. And it's like, is it something that should be waiting, or should I do it now? Because I'm getting a lot of pain from it, but I'm functional at this point, and I don't know how long.
So the first question was basically about vitamin and mineral supplements in the context of decreased absorption, right?
Right. Are they good for SCI people as they are for the general population?
Right. So, and I will tell you this. Yes. If you have a situation in which you have reduced absorption, vitamin and mineral supplements can help. I mean, and we don't have any data in the spinal cord injured population, but you know you can draw on other situations. A good place to draw the information, that I draw the information to, is if you look at some of the celiac literature. I mean, celiac disease is associated with decreased absorption of vitamins and minerals from the small intestine. And then once you get the disease under control by modifying the diet, what you also do in the early period is really give people high doses of vitamins and minerals, because yes, it does compensate for some of that malabsorption. Okay? So I kind of try to go to some of the other literature and sort of borrow from it when I make those decisions. But that's the answer to that question. And then the second question was about shoulder. And looking at you said a grade 3.
Right, so that's on the borderline where you can't get fixed because it's a tough.
Right, and what I have found is plan for this. We actually, let me take a step back and tell you what happened. Over the past few years, we've been seeing a lot more people with sort of more severe shoulder overuse injuries, having to go in and get a variety of surgeries, and then running into medical problems during the period of downtime or bed rest after the surgery. So what we did last year, the year before, is we brought as many of these folks in as we could, because there's no guidelines for people, which is what you're asking for. So we brought in these folks, and we just interviewed them all. And we said, tell us about your experience, tell us what we need to do, because this is at least a starting point in making some guidelines for people. And that's what we heard from people a lot, is plan. I can't tell you, you know, every individual is so different in terms of the success of the surgery. There are a couple articles out there, I'll tell you this, that I think scare some of the orthopedic surgeons away, because what the conclusions are is, well, people with spinal cord injury didn't do as well after rotator cuff repair as people without spinal cord injury. And I don't know that there's any truth in that. I think the population was different going in. I think the most important thing is getting your shoulder repaired is a big deal when you look at your whole life. And I do encourage people to do everything they can to try to get it taken care of, so you're not stuck in the situation that you're out and you're doing something with your arm and the whole thing rips. And so then you're stuck with having to deal with it at that moment in time. But what I do recommend is trying to get in with a surgeon who has some experience with people with spinal cord injury. And then if not, but you're in with a good surgeon, bring your spinal cord injury specialist into the fold early. Okay? Because that really is key. Then the problems I see in people after surgery really revolve around skin breakdown and pneumonia and infections. just because of the bed rest and just because you know, they didn't have everything they needed for that sort of recovery period. I don't know if that answered it completely, but there's not a solid answer to it.
You know, I know you heal slower as you get older, but at this point I'm kind of functional, and it's like, am I better off staying, you know, kind of a thing where you're better off staying functional without the surgery as long as possible, because the doctor that I talked with at least said that it's going to be the same operation whether I do it today or 10 years from now.
Right.
So
I guess the one thing to consider is, you know, really look hard. Are you really that functional? The other issue is, what we do know is in terms of a variety of joint repairs, people do better after the repair if they have some, it doesn't have to be formal therapy or exercise specifically to that joint before the repair. So you strengthen up the whole joint before the repair. Okay, and it's really commonplace now in sort of lower extremity joint replacements, knee replacements, which are, you know, how many of those are done every day? A ton of them. But that's more standard rehabilitation care right now. So I would just look really hard at your function and really, are you really functioning? Are you doing what you want to do? I mean, you can be happy with your function, but maybe you want to do some more things that is keeping your, that your shoulder is keeping you back. And if it is, then I'd recommend either pushing forward in some way, exercise, surgery, whatever is right for you.
We have another question here from the woman in green.
Marianne from Billerica, Mass. One of the things that I read is that something like 40% of people who live with spinal cord injury are classified as clinically depressed. And in the context of people who were consulting Dr. Kevorkian, discussing doing themselves in, those who were opposed to doing oneself in said that part of the reason why people wanted to commit suicide was inadequate pain control. And another thing that I've read is that a lot of people with spinal cord injuries have pain and are looking for pain relief, and a lot of the available treatments are not very effective. And it is also the case that a lot of doctors are a lot more worried now than they used to be about the abuse of prescription drugs, which means that they're a lot less willing to control pain if the main problem is pain rather than something else. And what I wondered was, in terms of both the quality and quantity of life, has the handling of pain entered at all into your research? And is that something you've looked into?
Yeah, we have. Like some of the studies that I was quoting, and I have to say, you know, our main focuses have been cardiovascular disease, overweight, obesity, rotator cuff, bones, body composition. But I have to say, the couple studies that I quoted, remember the DUH study, looking at exercise, and then the survey study, we also looked at pain as a health condition, as an associated health condition from an exercise standpoint. What we did find out was, like other things, like infections, like skin breakdowns, people who exercised more tend to have less pain. Now, that was just an association. It could have been the other way around. People exercised more because they had less pain. I'm not sure. I just know that, you know, more exercise generally equals less pain. So we have looked at it, and I think you're right. I think you bring up a really good point. When we talk to consumers, this is one of the primary complaints that we hear very consistently is pain. And yes, I do think that, and we have shown that pain is associated with depression. And that's even been showed in the non-spinal cord injury literature. I think, you know, the numbers that we hear quoted, 40%, that is high for depression and spinal cord injury. I mean, I typically see, especially right after an acute spinal cord injury, that depression tends to be overdiagnosed, and that's not uncommon to overdiagnose it. But I do think that this is a critical issue, and it's also one of the major reasons for use of a lot of medications. Now, in many people with pain, use of the medications to control the pain is totally appropriate. The only thing, and I'm not saying don't use the pain, the only thing, and I mentioned it in one bullet point in here, is we just need to think over time, what is the impact of you know, the additional medications, and I'm not talking just pain, I'm talking any medications that can affect your thinking. So spasticity medications is another big one. Over time, what is going to be the effect of the medications on aging? And we just need to consider it. And we just then we need to do what we can to try to get everyone, again, more successfully aging.
Well,
Denise has a... Oh, I'm sorry. I just want to make sure that we have time for everybody's questions, if that's okay. So we're going to actually move on to Denise and have her ask a question, and maybe you guys can talk offline afterwards.
So the question is, it is something I'd like to share. I'm 55 years old, 35-year post, C6-7 incomplete. I threw my shoulder out last fall. Slot on osteogy, prednisone, cortisone therapy. While there, I went to see an acupuncturist. With a lot of coming, which they don't do a lot these days because that's really old school, but I have not had to have surgery, and if my shoulder starts to throw, I call it my sports injury. I'll give him a call and see him, and he does really basic things like, well, cupping and acupuncture, of course, but Epsom salts, packs, also really help that pain. So just for all of us that are having that shoulder stuff, there are alternative ways.
Can you just wait until you get a mic? Thank you, Denise, for that. And I think we have another question on the internet in the back.
But thank you. I mean, I think that's a great suggestion, and we do need to keep all of these options in our repertoire.
I have two questions from the internet. The first one is, I'm a T1 post-motor vehicle accident when at 6 years of age, currently is 45 years old, and is nervous about all the mention of diabetes. Can you just address this, the occurrence of statistics, how we're hearing more and more about it, and how family history plays into that as well?
So what we found in some of our research, and I talked about this a bit, is people with tetraplegia had a greater propensity for diabetes and pre-diabetes than people with paraplegia. The prevalence numbers, and a lot of this work has been done out of the Bronx VA by Bill Bauman and Ann Spungen and their colleagues, but we're talking on the order of, and again, this is in a veteran population, a little bit different population, but not a lot different, of 50%-ish of tetraplegics. And again, my sort of take-home message from all the evidence that's out there now and some of our research is, don't necessarily be satisfied just with the fasting blood test. If you have tetraplegia, go and ask for that oral glucose tolerance test. It takes a little longer, it's a little more of a pain, but I think it's probably worth it. And I didn't hear, did I answer the last bit?
Well, we'd like to address the family history as well, and how that would occur.
Well, I mean, the main thing I can say, if there is a family history, then it's only going to increase those risks that I've talked about even further. So a little more fuel to the fire for, you know, going and getting checked.
Okay, thank you. And the other question is actually more of a comment that we'd like your comments on as well. My belief is that SCI individuals would age appropriately with a proper diet and exercise regime, just as an able-bodied person. But many people with SCI seem to give up on those ideas.
Well, possibly. But the bottom line is, our lifestyle has changed in this country. I mean, there are fast food places everywhere. Our diets tend to rely more on fast foods. Let me throw this out, because I have a whole hour talk that I talk about diet and nutrition, and I had no idea until I put this talk together. But do you guys know that, and I can't remember the time frame, in the last 20 years or so, that the regular plate sizes, just the size of your plate, has increased upwards of 30 to 50%. The size of our cups has increased, so we don't even know it, but the stuff we're buying to put our food on is considerably larger than it was about 20 or 30 years ago. So we still fill up our plates the same, but our plates are bigger, and so we fill up our bodies the same, but lifestyles have changed totally in this country. This is a cultural issue. And I was actually reassured to some degree by some of our diet research, and our folks with spinal cord injury actually did pretty darn well from an intake standpoint. Yes, fat intake could be less. Yes, you know, simple carbohydrate intake could be a little less, but we weren't doing any worse than the general population. We were probably doing a little better than the general population, but I do agree with the person on the internet. We still have to do better because, unfortunately, there's no room for error, I think, and you know, dietary intake for people with spinal cord injury really has to be nutrient dense.
I have a question in the back.
Hi. My boyfriend's paraplegic for about a little bit over a year, and he's lean and very muscular and fit. He doesn't do much exercise. Do you still think it's very important for him to exercise, even though he's very independent on himself and has lots of muscles?
Absolutely. And one of my take-home messages, I mean, exercise is important pretty much for every body system. I mean, we can go through it system by system, but we need it to keep our heart strong and we need it to keep fit. It's good for your skin, it's good for your muscles, it's good for your bones. But the other thing is, you know, when I talk about a lot of our obesity diet, I cannot emphasize enough that when we looked at people, 75% were overweight or obese, but I'm telling you, I looked at the majority of people and they don't look, I mean, they look like they're of normal weight, but they just have more fat and less muscle. So I would definitely encourage the exercise.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Great. Carol has a question down front here.
Thanks, Ron.
I was just curious, your suggestion, I know I've always yo-yoed weight and now being paralyzed, but I found that my caloric intake has been very, very low. And when I've gone and talked to dietitians, they worry about that. But, you know, so what is your suggested calorie intake?
Well, we don't have them. I think Dr. Nash quoted earlier. I mean, what can be done is an exercise physiologist like Dr. Nash can actually pretty simply do a little test and find out how much energy you burn, basically your energy expenditure. And then your exact caloric requirements can be determined from that. And you are exactly right. You're talking about that really tight window that you have to maintain, and you're right. You have to reduce your caloric intake. So what we found is, and no one has said, this is the tough part, no one separated out men and women. That was the nice thing about our nutrition study, at least in terms of intake. We were the first to separate out men and women. The difficulty in answering your question is all the energy expenditure studies have been done on men, which is different. So we have to sort of guess based on women and Yes, and that adds another little kink into it. But what I would guess is kind of depending on your level of injury, depending on your gender, there's going to be a reduction somewhere of daily caloric intake, somewhere I would guess in the 400 to 700 calories a day range. It's pretty substantial, okay? But I think you're right on the mark. You can have it measured, okay? But it's somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I'm talking from recommended levels. So there's the recommended levels, and then there's what people actually take in, which is there's a difference there, too.
I have the gentleman down front with a question.
Hi, thank you. Hi, Dr. Angel from Boston. And you did have a
follow-up. Yep.
Angel from Boston, and you did have a fun talk.
Thank you.
A lead-in, and then the question. Infections are one of the major causes of end-of-life decline. I've read that the American Academy of Sciences has called chlorine dioxide the greatest anti-pathogen known to man. And there are several products available on the market. One is from like miraclemineral.org. it is a chlorine dioxide generator, especially for people with SCI. Is there any research and or would you recommend chlorine dioxide and or a chlorine dioxide generator?
I have to say, it's ironic that you bring this up because someone else mentioned that to me, I mean, just 2 or 3 days ago. And I have to say, I don't know anything about it yet. I had the first mention, but it's kind of funny. This is the second mention in just a matter of days. But I do know that in the SCI literature, there's certainly no research out there to that extent. But yeah, I mean, just like I think in one of the other questions I answered, there's a lot of areas where we don't have the research in spinal cord injury, but you know, we go to the general population, we go to other populations and borrow from that, but I can't answer the question directly.
There's a gentleman in blue behind. Ron? Oh, I'm sorry. There's a gentleman here in blue, Spinwee. Thank you.
Just quickly, the doctor this morning mentioned the Mediterranean diet as one that we could take a look at for spinal cord injured folks. Do you have one that you recommend or prefer or suggest?
Well, what we've actually, and I was surprised Dr. Nash, and this just must have slipped his mind. I mean, the one that I've always gone to was actually given to me by our dietitian. It's actually called the Mediterranean diet. And so I've used that. But there was actually, Dr. Nash and I worked together on one of the journals, the Topics in Spinal Cord Injury Rehab, that came out 2 years ago. So winter of 2009, because it was in January. But there's an article in there by Sarah Fiesel, and she's a dietitian, and a large piece of that actually talks about the Mediterranean diet and the potential benefits in people with spinal cord injury. So that might be a good resource. I know it's the second time that question's come up. But it's Sarah Fiesel is the author. You spell her last name F-E-A-S-E-L. Okay.
Great. I think we have time for a few more questions. And Ron, if you don't mind, this woman in the green, please.
Hi. The other question I was going to ask earlier was, is there any research to suggest that the lack of increased life expectancy for people with spinal cord injury that's happened recently has anything to do with the lack of either availability or coverage of insurance, you know, co-payments and those sorts of things?
Evidence, no. Speculation, yes. The closest sort of data we have to answer that question is looking kind of over the same time frame or maybe in a longer time frame because, you know, from what, 1990 to now, immediately after someone's had their injury and you go through acute rehab, those acute rehab days have been shortened. And so one thing that we have seen over that same time span is an increase in people being readmitted to the hospital during that first year. So because of that data, yes, there is quite a bit of speculation that, you know, because of limited health care coverage, but we don't know what, preventive care, acute hospital care, is that contributing to this, what I'm calling the increasing gap or the increasing disparity? And actually, we're just now analyzing some new data. We have a very large-scale study going on right now. And it was just this week at work, we looked at the data and we looked at people just in the 6 months after discharge from acute rehab. So it wasn't even the full first year. And the number of rehospitalizations was just through the roof. So it could be related. I mean, number of days for acute rehab is just, in, not everywhere, but in many places is very low right now.
I think we're going to take one more question in the back here.
Hi, I'd like to ask, when it comes to vitamins and calcium, do we take the regular recommended amount as everybody else, even though we have this injury?
I'm sorry, could you repeat, please?
When it comes to vitamins and calcium pills, do we take the recommended allowance as everybody else?
Yes, there's nothing to indicate that you would take any different. Just like the general population, vitamin D is a big hot item right now, and we're really seeing, as we're looking harder, a lot more vitamin D deficiency. So the other thing I would recommend, and I think there was another study that just came out in the spinal cord injured population, really documenting that vitamin D deficiencies are very, very prevalent in people with spinal cord injury. And so that obviously affects your absorption of calcium. So I'd also recommend that, getting that level actually checked.
Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you.
I can see Dr. Williams coming up, but before he gets here, I would just like to thank our and Dr. Nash, Susan Howley, and Dr. Groh, to thank our sponsors and exhibitors for making this possible, and to thank all the folks from Boston Medical Center, especially Dr. Williams, because you're my hero. And then just thank the audience today for allowing me to be up here and to be with you. So thank you so much.
And I would like to thank you for attending today, and I would like to remind you to please fill out the survey so that in the upcoming conferences we can bring topics to the conferences that are of interest to you. And I would like to wish you all well and a safe trip home, and thank you for spending the day with us. Have a good day.